Episode 41. Let's do this.
This is the business of architecture. Helping architects conquer the world. And here's your host, Enoch Sears.
I am your host, Enoch Bartlett Sears, and you've tuned to the right place to learn about what they didn't teach us in design school. How to make enough money as architects so we can run a great practice and a good business. Now, first today, I want to give a shout out to Jeff Winnie of Samish and DiBella Architects out of Mesa, Arizona. Hey, thanks, Jeff, for leaving the review on iTunes. I appreciate it. Now, if you haven't left a review for Business of Architecture on iTunes, you know, I'd appreciate some honest feedback over there. And if you don't have iTunes, you can head over to Business of Architecture and leave a comment on today's show. If you're on iTunes, go ahead and do a search in the iTunes store for Business of Architecture. You'll see it listed there under the podcast section. Go ahead and leave your comment and your feedback there, and I'd appreciate that. So today is the second part of my conversation with architect Brian Lewis. Brian is the principal of the Caribbean architecture firm ACLA Works, based in Trinidad and Tobago. He is co-editor of the book Mannequin, The Architecture and Art of Anthony C. Lewis. He's also currently producing a book on contemporary Caribbean architecture, which is very interesting. In today's show, we're going to talk a little bit about whether you should focus on an area in architecture that you're passionate about. We talk about the difference between sales versus marketing, tips for closing the sale, how to craft a good RFP, and the importance of listening and how to address concerns. We also talk a little bit about architectural photography. Brian Lewis is an accomplished architectural photographer, and he shares with us some tips for getting the most out of your photographs of your projects, and also how to go about hiring an architectural photographer, as well as we even discuss some of the rates and how much you can expect to pay to get that project photographed. So without further ado, here's the show. Hey, Architect Nation, welcome back to Business of Architecture. Today is part two of our interview with Brian Lewis from Trinidad and Tobago. He is a principal and practicing manager of ACLA Works, based in Trinidad and Tobago. So welcome back to the show, Brian.
Thank you, Enoch. Glad to be again.
Yeah, it's definitely excellent to have you. And last time, you know, you made some very interesting commentary about how the practice of architecture has changed over time, about developing a strategic plan for an architecture firm and changing with the changes that happen. I mean, being flexible and executing, following up. Let's dive a little bit into the process of going through that strategic plan. And something that you talked to me about was figuring out what makes you unique. Do you have any commentary about that process?
Well, I think, I'm doing this off the top of my head.
You bet.
I think you need to begin by looking at your strengths and weaknesses and being very honest about what your capabilities are. I think you need to be looking at the market to see where the work is. Yeah, I think you really need to examine yourself very honestly to determine the kind of work that you would like to do.
Yeah.
I think that's very important. There's no point trying to be something that you're not.
Okay.
You need to really know what sort of work you're looking for and position yourself for that work.
Yeah.
And project yourself in your branding, which is not just a letterhead, it's everything that you are. So every aspect of your firm and all the officers or staff of your firm need to be on board with that branding approach. So you need to know what the firm is about, and it needs to be very clear in simple language, not very complex kind of architectural language.
Yeah. You talked about doing things, identifying what you like doing something that excites your passion. And I'd like to ask a follow-up question. You know, what is the value of doing that? What benefit? Why should someone do that as opposed to just doing something that makes money or?
Well, I think surely we can. The things that we feel passionate about ought to be able to make a living from that. I think one would be much more committed to something that you believe in. And some clients as well, I should add, hire architects for the area that they are really interested in, the theories that they have or the commitment they have to a particular idea. They're not just hiring a firm, but they're actually, maybe it's to do with sustainability, for example. And they're looking for an architect who can deliver a green building or something. So unless you're locked into all of that, you know, in an authentic way, I would add, I don't think you would stand a chance for that kind of client. So for clients who are looking for specific areas of expertise, if you want to call it that, then I think you have to be very committed to those areas for that to come across to the client, so, because they will perceive and understand very quickly whether you're authentic or not. You can't just say, "Oh, I'm interested in green architecture." You have to show what you know and what you've done in that area, and what it could. You have to really feel passionate about it.
Okay. Now I have a note here from you, Brian, that says that sales is not marketing. Explain that.
Yeah. Well, there are other people I think who could do a much better job of that. But sales, you know, marketing is positioning yourself. Understanding where the market is, what you can offer, and so on. That's the strategic planning of it. Sales is really more to do with closing, as it were, closing on a project. In other words, you might be doing a RFP or a proposal or making an interview, let's say a competitive interview with other firms, and I would classify that as sales, you know, in other words. But even going after RFP should be thought of also as a sales activity. In other words, you need to analyze your client very carefully. Usually it would be more than one person, and each person on the committee, as it were, who are interviewing you or considering your proposal, have a different function, and you need to understand how they are thinking and make sure your proposal addresses their concerns. And if you are so fortunate to reach to an interview as well, you need to be very sensitive to the different roles that the various persons on their committee, on the billing committee or whatever, what their roles have, and to listen very carefully to what their concerns are and address that. I would say that is sales. In my opinion, that's what it is. So it's a different activity than marketing, although they're very closely allied, you know, but yeah. One is more to closing and the other one is strategic, you know.
Sure. What have you seen to be the most important things in terms of the sales process, maybe the one or two salient points of the selling of architectural services that have been useful for you?
Well, I think architecture is a visual profession. I think we should sell our work. People need to see it. Like, you can't talk about architecture except in a theoretical way, and I think that would bore the hell out of most people. And architects need to take note of that. We are very good at that, apparently. But I think it is very much a visual presentation of our work, and it needs to be done in a way that explains the architecture, explains what you're trying to do. And so one of the things that I've developed, which I don't know if you can splice in at some point in this interview, is develop all the different areas of a strategic plan for a firm, whether it be items to do with the media or social media or doing brochures or whatever, or a whole array of activities that a firm might use to get their message to the public. The one thing that comes across to me very strong, because it's a visual profession, is the role of architectural photography. And it really impacts on almost every single element component of a strategic plan. And it's part of your branding as well, the way you exhibit all these things. And I think most clients, certainly bigger clients, for every client, a building project is a major investment, whether it be a house for a family, or whether it be a judicial complex for a nation or a city. These are major investments. And I think it is only appropriate that architects who are interested in being considered for this type of work invest in presenting their work really well. And that needs to be, you know, it's not just a question of going out with a little camera and taking pictures. I think you can see good architectural photography is worth the investment, because you're talking about huge commissions. Architects get, you know, their commissions can be very few and far between, and they're major commissions. So the investment in having good photography done of work which you have spent maybe 5-10 years on, a project, maybe, you know, a bigger project, let us say, could easily be 5-10 years. You know, you shouldn't take that lightly. You know, I think clients would expect to see from you very, very good images, which explains the work, explains the architecture, and is convincing for them. You know, I think that's one of the key tools that we have, apart from the personal relationships, which I talked about earlier. So you have the photography aspect, which is part of your branding and so on, and then you have the personal relationships. So I think that's very important, as I see it, you know. And many architects don't spend enough time, in my view, presenting their work properly. And I think they are disadvantaged. They may be relying on different attractive elements, whether it be personal relationships and so on, to get work, or some other aspect. But a very important part is visual presentation. And that's something that I'm personally quite interested in. And I actually have, because things got slow in the Caribbean a couple of years ago, I decided, you know, because I've been doing photography all my life, that I would do. We have done a book in our firm. I've done a book for a firm about 3 or 4 years ago, and that's something I would recommend to firms. It's not as hard as you think. We did it entirely in our own office. All the graphics, all the photography, all the texts. We'd have a little bit of help from one or two people, but and we printed the book next door, and it's a very, very well done publication, I might add. So I'm now on my second one, which is a book on contemporary Caribbean architecture, in which I am hoping that that if the public can see in a single publication of, let's say, 40 or 50 really well designed contemporary homes, well presented, that they would have a better reference point for their work in the future, because certainly in the Caribbean, work tends to be a little kind of, generally speaking, a bit kind of traditional in terms of what is Caribbean, you know, so almost like little crisscross balconies and stuff like that, you know, and I think we have to get beyond that. Right now, you know, we have a tremendous reference point of traditional Caribbean colonial architecture, and it's time, in my view, to have a new reference point, which is what I'm working on. So I've started about 2 or 3 years ago, doing a lot of different islands. So I started in the Windward Islands. I'm now did the Leeward Islands this year, and next year I'm doing the Greater Antilles, and hopefully publish in 2015, and hopefully that'll be my final. But you know, that's, I'm interested in architectural photography myself, you know, and I see the value of it. And I know that the larger firms in North America and so on, they certainly understand the value of it. You know.
Well, that sounds like an excellent way to see the Caribbean, Brian.
Yeah, for me, if you read my blog and so on, the latest one I have is it's quite interesting, you know, writing about the actual trip of the islands.
Yeah, and I do encourage our visitors to go check out your blog. It's actually quite interesting. You've got some amazing photographs in there and some amazing Caribbean architecture. So tell us where they can go to read more about that and see those beautiful images.
Well, lumisphotography.com.
Okay.
And lumisphotography.com. And up there you'll see quite a bit of the work that I've been doing over the last couple of years, you know, and taking pictures of buildings up and down the Caribbean, you know. Plus I've got a lot of blogs and things like that of interest. You know.
Yeah. Well, I'll also put a note to that, a link in the show notes so people can go check that out, because I think that's a really good thing. If they spend even 5 minutes browsing that site, they can learn a lot about presentation and about presenting projects. Brian?
Well, and as you know, I was very keen on the details of how it came across, you know, so you were very helpful in helping me streamline the website to get the look I'm really interested in.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Brian's referring to the fact that he brought us on as consultants to take his website, so to speak, to the next level, kind of upgrade the appearance of it and do some things in terms of optimization. And so it was definitely a fun project to work on, Brian. All that eye candy, all the beautiful photos you have on there, it was very fun just to look at them. You know, I'm as an architect, you know, looking at beautiful images of buildings is a favorite pastime.
Yeah, with all the negative comments I made earlier, I mean, I think we need to have a positive outlook for our profession. I'm hoping that this is what it's all about now.
Yeah. Brian, what tips can you give us for architects to select an architectural photographer to shoot their projects?
Right. All right. Okay. Well, I think obviously, you know, the web is very helpful starting point. Then, you know, so you can do some research. You need to look at the work that photographers in your area have done. Obviously, bringing in somebody from outside is going to have added travel expenses. And then once you have, as it were, identified, let's say, two or three photographers that you like their work, think it reflects. Also, I think I would say that some photographers, when you look at the buildings that they photograph, tells you a lot about the photographer. Some photographers don't know anything about architecture. They know about flash and light and all those things. There's technical matters. They don't understand architecture. So you need to look at the work that they're photographing. That tells you a lot about the photographer and his sensibilities.
Would you recommend that architects look for someone who specializes in architectural photography, or will just any photographer do?
No, absolutely. Sorry, if I didn't make that clear, let me do so now. Absolutely, yeah. Portrait photographers and so on. No. Architectural photography is definitely specialization. It requires special equipment, special understanding of architecture, and a completely different approach than, you know, than portrait or any sort of commercial photography. Completely different, much more contemplative, takes a long time. You should understand that. So I think selecting a photographer, an architectural photographer that does buildings that I think that closely align with what you're trying to do would be a good start. Having shortlisted two or three of them, obviously, make contact, discuss what they can do for you and what sort of rates they have and all that kind of stuff. And eventually, you make a selection. And you know, even preparing buildings for photography is important. Eh? Remember that this photograph that this architectural photographer is going to take of your work of architecture, you may have spent 5 or 10 years on. Every detail that goes into that photograph is absolutely critical to the effect that you're going to have. So it may require from the architect a little bit extra work as well, making sure that the building is painted properly, that the lawn is cut, that the lights and sprinklers are not going to come on and wet on everybody. You know, all those kind of details are actually very important in getting the end result that you're looking for. And a little bit of extra work by the architect. And also, I didn't mention this, but I mean, I think it would be important once you're closing in on the selection of the architect or photographer to ideally meet with them, to discuss the design over drawings or whatever that you have, or even photographs, and so that you explain to the architect the design concept and the sort of effects that you're looking for, the angles and so on. We also respecting their ability to come up with their own ideas too, you know. They're not just going there to snap three angles that you think are good, but there may be quite a different approach that the photographer might have. And it's only through open discussion, I think, that you can, as it will, get to the best result. You're obviously, the firm of architects has something in mind, and that needs to be communicated. But the photographer, any good? I mean, they have.
And what are the sort of distinguishing characteristics? How can architects look at a photo? What things should they be looking at to distinguish if the photographer is what we would call a good photographer?
Well, I said the first thing I think is the kind of buildings of the photographs. I mean, if you're trying to do very smart contemporary buildings, you know, and this photographer is taking sort of ranch houses and historic churches and so on, maybe you got the wrong photographer. So you need to look at the work, I think, that they tend to do. I mean, if they are constantly doing work for good architects as well, that would be another clue. In terms of the actual photographs, it's difficult to discuss in words, but is the view of the building really enhancing the building, or is it the wrong time of day, or are the verticals all out, are people all over the place, or, you know, confusing things, is there stuff on the driveway, signs on the building, you know, all kinds of things can give you a clue that they're not really the best, you know. It's difficult to explain without a photograph in front of me what is good. But architects have a good eye. So any architect, I think, worth his salt would know. You know, we are visual people. We will know.
Yeah,
just
the same way
you speak well about some of my photographs. And I think I respect that most architects would know what a good photograph is.
Agreed. Now, I know my next question is going to be difficult to answer, and you'll see why in a second, but I want to give our listeners a general idea of a budget they could expect to set aside for architectural photographs. Is there some idea you can give them of sort of just planning ahead on the budget?
All right, okay. Yeah, well, it's very elastic, of course. It depends on the size of the project and so on. I mean, I would say that any sort of residential scale or smaller building even would require ideally more than a day. I think for an architect to expect a photographer to arrive at his building at 9 o'clock in the morning and leave at 9 o'clock at night and get every aspect of the building it can be done. And this is what I have to do, unfortunately, of the islands, because I have very limited time for each project, and it's very difficult to capture every aspect in one day, I would say. So I would say ideally 2 or 3 days would be, I mean, there's also the weather to take into account. Huh? So you might arrive there on a day when, even though you can predict weather to some extent, you know, you can't as well. So I would say 2 to 3 days for any sort of smallish project. And of course, a large project would require more time. In terms of budget, you know, it varies, of course, between photographers who are now starting and those established photographers. But I would say it varies between, let's say, between $1,500 and $2,500 US dollars a day. Don't forget that also for every day in the field, you have to allow another day in post-production. Today, digital photography requires a lot of time after the photograph has been taken. And that has to be paid for. So, you know, a 2-day photo shoot actually takes 4 days, you know, of the photographer. So it's virtually a week gone.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's 52 weeks in a year, and that you have to make a living, you know.
Yeah.
So I would say somewhere about 2,000 US a day, plus whatever expenses in terms of traveling and so on. And it depends on what the output is. Does it include prints?
Or,
you know, I mean, prints would be paid for per print and so on, and size and all these variables. And in the discussions with your photographer, all of this needs to, of course, be clarified.
Yeah.
What is the purpose of the photography?
Mm-hmm.
And usually architects want it for general use. And most photographers are very, very open about the copyright issues with architects, because they understand that they're also artists and they need it for their brochure, their website, and so on. I mean, obviously, if they're going to sell the photograph to some supplier of floor tiles or glass or something, and somebody's going to make money from it, then that's a consideration that needs to be priced. You know? But generally speaking, most architectural photographers would give, the exception of publication for money and so on, open, you know, copyright release, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so I'm just looking at just a general... Oh, Brian, I was just saying, so just number-wise, I'm looking at a general budget of anywhere for a small project, maybe a residential project, from $5,000 to $15,000.
No, I would say less than that. I would say the smallest, I would say about $1,500 and maybe going up maybe $2,000 a day, depending on the amount of days to do that they agree to do the job, because, I mean, the architect has to... But at the end of the day, if you've done a project that's worth $100 million, I mean, should you really be concerned about whether it takes 3 days or 5 days? I mean, surely what you're really looking for at that point is really stunning images that will, and these images are going to last for a long time. So
absolutely. I definitely understand the investment aspect of it. So when you say, you know, 1500 to 2000 a day, if we're looking at, you know, for a residential project, let's say 2 days in the field, 1 day post-production at 1500 a day, that's $4,500.
Yeah, somewhere around that.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, fair. It's good to have an idea.
Yeah.
And Brian, now we know obviously that it's optimal that they have a professional do it. But at the same time, we know there's a lot of architects out there who are do-it-yourselfers, and maybe some of them even have some pretty nice equipment. What sort of tips would you give to architects that just feel they can't justify the cost and they just are intent on shooting their own photos?
Mm-hmm. Well, get yourself a tripod, number one, because architectural photography, you know, you're not just cruising around snapping pictures. It requires careful composition, perhaps aligning your verticals and things like that. So you might need bubble levels and stuff like that. You may need a shift lens, which is a lens that moves, that allows you to correct the perspective on the architects need. You know, they need buildings that are not sloping backwards and falling down and so on.
So in other words, the convergence of lines from perspective, the shift lens will straighten that out.
Yeah, ideally you should have a shift lens, and certainly I think the two elements of tripod, you'd be surprised at how important a tripod is in terms of the resolution. And I didn't talk much about resolution, but architectural photographs tend to eventually get enlarged quite big. And if you don't use a tripod, you'll find quite a tremendous difference when you blow up a photograph in the resolution that you end up with. So a tripod is well worth the investment. Then you might need lighting, you know, for interiors. You have to illuminate what you're seeing, you know, and unless it's a very bright interior. And even if it's a bright interior, you need to understand how to deal with the contrast that you're going to get with bright interiors. You know? So there's a lot to it.
What kind of lighting would be suggested for a do-it-yourselfer?
Well, the simplest thing for do-it-yourself would probably be a couple of flashes, you know. So which you can have connected with a transmitter and so on. But you could, I mean, that's easy to pack, you know, you can put it in something small if you, I mean, for more professionals would use a tungsten lights on tripods or flashes on tripods. And of course that takes up a lot of, that's much more professional. But I think little flashes would be adequate for lighting. Tripod, shift lens, good camera, and probably some knowledge of Photoshop would be helpful as well. Because that's actually, I find very challenging myself, you know.
Yeah. Well, in terms of, let's talk about the lighting. If they have the flashes that are connected by a transmitter, where do you generally try to put the flashes in the room to get an even illumination on the interior shots?
Well, you might want to get even illumination. I think what you want to light, essentially, the features that you're trying to illuminate, to
accentuate.
Yeah, so, you know, it really... You know, it may not be a flat lighting you're looking for at all, you know. In fact, the lighting that you have to introduce into a scene should almost be unobservable in the photograph.
Yeah.
So I think it might be low levels of illumination to reduce the contrast in the interior to a point where the film, what it, the sensor, I should say, because we're not using film anymore, to a point where the sensor can pick up detail, because it, you know, it's not as nearly as responsive as an eye is. A sensor has, and different sensors on different cameras are much more sensitive than others. For instance, Hasselblad has like 12 or 13 stop range, you know, whereas a simple little Nikon or, you know, small 35 millimeter might have a 5 or 7 stop range. So the amount of information that it can contain in a single image is huge difference, you know. But lighting can help bring it back in within the range of the sensor. That's the point, really, I'm trying to get at.
Excellent, excellent.
So if you find that the view is very high contrast lighting, if you do it carefully, you can more evenly lit that one, you know.
Yeah.
Sometimes your lighting features, sometimes you're dealing with contrast. That's the point.
Okay. Brian, do you have an image that you were particularly pleased with that you've done, an interior that you can send us to so we can go look at it?
Yeah. I think one of them that I did in a total office project, which is a recent interior I did, because I haven't done too many interiors as such. This is actually an interior building. I don't know how to describe it. I can communicate which one to you.
Yeah, which one it is, and then I'll put a link to it on the show notes.
It's the one with the orange chair in it, you know, in Total Office. That one, and actually the exterior of that same Total Office was also an interesting shot. Because at the time I took it, there's only one exterior, so you can easily find it. The light was dropping very fast, and then unfortunately, the street light came on right next door, and everything went sort of purple or whatever, green or something. So, I had a very short window in which to shoot the shot eventually. But, Photoshop helps a lot, you know.
Yeah. Is it on your Lumis Photography website?
Yeah, in Total Office, I think in the last blog and one of the blogs, 9.3 or whatever, I can't remember.
So is it... Is it in a blog post, or can I get to it by project, by country, or project by architect?
I think it's in a blog post, yeah.
Okay. So if I go to the blog, and then I'll just link to it, and...
Mm-hmm. Well, your question is, which is my favorite photograph? The last one I took.
Yeah.
And that was the last one I took a couple of weeks ago, you know?
So, yeah. Yeah, I see it's very nice. I'm looking at it now. It turned out gorgeous. Yeah, the interior photos, man, just what even lighting. It's just really well,
mm-hmm.
very, very nice. So I'll put a link up to this because this turned out well. Were you using interior flashes on this?
Yes, I did on the shot with the orange chair. Yes, I had to, because the light was coming from the right side of the chair.
Yeah.
The light through a large window. And I had to bump up the light on the left side, the because it was just too much, and the contrast was again too big. You know?
Yeah.
So I did use a flash on the left. Yeah.
So basically, kind of out of the frame of the photo on a tripod, you had another flash casting backlight that direction.
Right, but you can't tell really.
No, I can't tell. Mm-mm.
It's really a, and that's the point. You know, you don't want to see. You have to be looking at the shadows. And this is the first time I shot tethered as well, you know, so I was able to study it on a computer as I was shooting. And we shot hundreds of photographs, and it's real fun working with a computer instead of just looking at through the viewfinder and so on. So a lot more control, I would say. Yeah, I'm going to be shooting tethered from now.
Yep. Well, Brian, it's been a pleasure speaking, and I enjoy where the conversation's gone. We sort of started out talking about marketing, but then we focused in on the architectural photography, which is good because I haven't touched on that much here on the show.
Yeah, well, I'm glad I was able to help with that, you know.
Absolutely.
Yeah, because I think it's very important. We are visual architects, or visual people. We can't present our work well. You know, you're doing yourself an injustice. You know?
Yeah, absolutely.
And
great. Well, any parting thoughts, Brian, about promotion of an architecture firm?
No, I just like to say once again, you have to look at your specific market to determine what method of marketing really, or where your focus really needs to be in your particular market. And not just follow other people's or other professional views on what to do. I think you really need to be in touch with your market and focus your effort on their needs. You know, it's a big topic, and I think the most important aspect of an architect's profession right now. I it's amazing how it has changed. You know? I think if you somebody said recently, I think you can be a good architect and have lousy marketing, you'll end up poor. But you can be a lousy architect and have good marketing and probably make a living out of it. You know? So it's something worth thinking about. Marketing can help you get further than you would without it, for sure.
Excellent. So, well, that's a great place to a great note to end on.
Yeah.
Thank you, Brian, for joining us all the way from Trinidad and Tobago.
Yeah, well, thank you very much for having me.
It's been my pleasure. Bye-bye.
Okay. Bye-bye.
And that's a wrap for another show about the business of architecture. To get more resources about how you as an architect can raise your fees, land the projects you love to work on, and get the time in your day back, join the members-only Business of Architecture Insider list for free by going to businessofarchitecture.com/free. Enter your best email address there, and I will send you instant access to free resources, including my book, Social Media for Architects. If you'd like to discuss a thought or insight from today's show, visit businessofarchitecture.com/podcast. On that page, you'll also find my notes from today's show and the action items I took away from our conversation. Until next week, keep rocking and go conquer the world. The views expressed on the show by my guests do not represent those of the host, and I make no representation, promise, guarantee, pledge, warranty, contract, bond, or commitment except to help architects conquer the world. Bump music credit to Ben Folds 5, Do It Anyway.